Welcome to BizHack Live, the weekly webinar series that BizHack Academy offers to the community to help you with your digital marketing for small businesses, micro enterprises, and boutique agencies. My name is Dan Gretsch, and I'm excited that we're going to have Sheryl Catell, one of BizHack's instructors, as well as a mentor of mine in the art of marketing, talking about a term that we kind of came up with together, which is method marketing. Just like method acting, how do you put yourself into the shoes of your customers to create campaigns that are going to be something that they respond to? My name again is Dan Gretsch. I'm the founder and CEO of BizHack Academy. I was a journalist for 15 years, was part of a Pulitzer Prize at my time in the Miami Herald, worked at NPR, PBS, and the Washington Post before converting into a digital marketer for a billion-dollar energy company and two software startups, and now as an educator of small businesses. I'm a Princeton alum, got a master's degree in storytelling at FIU, and was a Fulbright scholar. And our mission is to serve small businesses, micro enterprises, folks with small budgets, small staff, really resource constrained, the owners and entrepreneurs that make up about 50% of our economy, 70% of our employment, and in many cases are among the most endangered by the moment in which we live and by COVID and the impact it's having. We have partnered with more than 25 organizations, including the venture mentoring team, who's on the call today. It's founder Bob Nelson. Great to have you here, Bob. As well as Miami Bayside Foundation, the Florida State Minority Supplier Diversity Council, and others. And in partnership with them, we have launched, as of March, in response to both COVID and the Black Lives Matter movement, a scholarship program for women and entrepreneurs of color. We've had more than 250 applicants to date. 35 businesses and entrepreneurs have qualified for scholarships, valuing more than $50,000. And we invite any of you who are on the call today, who are interested in applying and learning more for that program, to go to try.bizhack.com/scholarship and to apply. The scholarship is to help defray the cost of our next five-week program, which starts on November 2nd. This is a accelerated course for business owners and mid-career professionals to get you started with and generating leads online, how to find customers online and close them as sales. And in 2019, we had more than 112 businesses run through the program and made $29 in sales for every $1 they spend in advertising while in the course. If you're interested in learning more about it, please sign up for our scholarship info session, which is gonna be held this Friday at noon. Sorry, that's a little bit of a typo. It's Friday at noon. And if you apply for the scholarship, or even just message us your email address, we can invite you to that info session. I wanted to acknowledge our partners, South Florida IMA and Miami Marketers. Sheryl Catell has been instrumental in making South Florida IMA a go-to place for marketers. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that when I introduce her. Now the BizHack Live series is a weekly series held 12:30 every Wednesday. And it's a chance for you to learn about the latest in digital marketing. And we have just an unbelievable lineup coming up. In fact, we're already booked all the way through February of next year. And I'm gonna run quickly through some of the guys that we have coming up. And I think you'll be excited by what we have coming up. So next week, we're gonna have Rosemary Ravenel back, formerly of Univision, to talk about Zoom mastery. This is specifically about how to use Zoom effectively for sales and marketing. And it's an incredibly powerful training that I highly recommend. This should not be in my background. This should be instead. I'm just doing a little bit of what Rosemary taught me in how to create a nice professional background for live presentations. This is going to be an unbelievable session. She has created something called the Zoom score, which she's trademarked, and she's going to introduce that concept of how you can give yourself a score in terms of how you present on Zoom. The week after that, we're going to be talking about mobile marketing in Latin America. A lot of us do business in Latin America. Mobile access in Latin America is higher penetration than even the United States. It's how they communicate. And to understand how to market using mobile in Latin America is critical. I'm then going to do a reprise with the Idea Center at Miami-Dade College, one of our partners, of my signature presentation, The Five Pillars of Digital Campaigns. We normally charge $50 for this presentation. It's an hour and a half. But with the Idea Center sponsorship, we're going to be offering it free to our community. After that, we're going to have Getting Heard in an Overcrowded World, The Seven Keys to Exponential Marketing, Free Tools to Find Your Ideal Customer Online with Emerge Americas, our Digital Marketers Graduation Party, and then Networking for Business Growth in January, How to Turn Contacts into Sales. It's an amazing lineup. Really excited. Now, you can sign up individually for each of these. Or you can sign up once and get an invitation, a calendar invite, and a summary with a recording of all of these sessions sent directly to your inbox. That's called our season pass. It's only $25, saves you a ton of time and bother. Why would you bother signing up for all these individually when you can sign up for all of them at once? So we'll put that link as well into the chat, and would love for you to just sign up for a season pass. The season pass, the money that we raise from that is also used to defray the significant expense that these free webinars cost us. So your support would be invaluable to us, and you'll get the benefit of getting a follow-up email with a recording of each of these without having to necessarily attend if you have a conflict on Wednesdays. Now let's talk about Sheryl Catell for a sec. So the first thing I can do is I could read to you this unbelievable bio. It's four paragraphs. It would bore all of you. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to speak from the heart, if that's okay, Sheryl.
Yes, of course. Absolutely.
Sheryl Catell is my marketing mentor and my marketing guru. I first met Sheryl as part of the South Florida Integrated Marketing Association, one of the top networking and education groups for marketers in South Florida, a group that she founded and helped build with the help of many folks over many years. She's an extraordinary leader and visionary, and she has the heart of gold, and she's willing to put significant time and effort in giving back. Sheryl is also a master marketer with an expertise in how technology and business interplay. And marketing is not marketing today without technology, but you also need to understand and put yourself in the shoes of your customers. And I've never met anyone better than Sheryl at both combining technology with empathy and providing empathetic marketing and technology solutions for businesses. And then finally, I've gotten a chance to know Sheryl through her coaching and instruction in the BizHack program. She's become fast favorite of all of our participants, brilliant at using LinkedIn strategies to help drive B2B leads, but even more importantly, to give personalized coaching and solutions in her one-on-one sessions that are tailored to the needs of the customer. And I gotta say, I've sat in on a couple of them, been even the beneficiary of a couple of those coaching sessions. And what's amazing to me is how different each of those coaching sessions look, one from the other, because she starts by asking what folks need and then listening carefully to their responses and adapting what she does to them. So it's with distinct pleasure and true honor that I welcome Sheryl Catell to the stage to present on method marketing, how to put yourself in the shoes of your customers. Thank you, Sheryl.
Thank you, Dan. Wow, I am humbled. I am so humbled by that introduction. Wow, I'd like to know who that person is. I feel like I should go to the Zoom meeting first and then come back and do this, but we'll push on, we'll push on. I will be there next week though. So yes, I probably should start by saying, you know, how did we get here? Because it is all Dan's fault. We talked about my approach in one of my coaching sessions, and he said, "You do method marketing," and I didn't even know what it was. You know, when he suggested that title, I just do marketing. I do marketing the way I've always done it throughout my whole life, throughout my whole career. So it's really his fault. And then I came out with this insight instead of inside out marketing. In that it comes from within, and it comes from an insight that is so powerful that I thought it was a good way to describe method marketing. So, all right, go ahead and we'll get started. I think we can probably go ahead and advance. Yeah, great. So we could probably skip this one. Other than I do want to say that just recently I have just launched a new business and I've got a, it's called personal legend coaching.com. And I've been able to apply a lot of the things that I've been doing in a business sense to more personal things using creative visualization as one of the main primary things. So that's the only thing I don't think you talked about, Dean, but otherwise you got it. You really did it. All right, so this is our outline. We're going to talk about the origins of this method marketing, which is really method acting. Definition and some mistakes that I think folks make, some techniques. I'm going to give you three techniques and tips and tricks. Actually, I'm going to give you four. You get a bonus, no charge. Tips and tricks, pros and cons of using method marketing, the importance of improvisation, and then I'll give you some, end up with some resources. Now, I know the presentation as well as the recording link will be available at the end. All right. So we're going to start in a good interactive way with a poll. And so Lilia, if you could please start with the poll. I'm just curious how many of you in the audience have ever heard of this thing called method acting. Because the more you know about method acting, then the easier it'll be for me to talk about method marketing. So this is just a way for us to find out. As I said, this is not my name. This is actually Dan named it, but then I'll show you some history that there is actually a book about this. So. Anyway, so hopefully everybody can see the poll. If you're on the phone, I don't think you can. So we may be a few short. We've got about 76% in. You go ahead and show it, Lilia. Thank you for doing that. All right, so good news is almost 60% of us have heard of method acting. So that'll help, but there's still about 45% who haven't. So we'll go ahead and continue with the formal part of our program. All right, so this is the origin. Konstantin Stanislavski. Sometimes his name is spelled with a K, sometimes it's with a C. But he is the Russian person who came up with this methodology. And it, in his words, he says, it's really more than just memorizing lines and reciting them. So if you think about marketing, it's more than memorizing marketing research. It's and then reciting it or feeding it back. You become so convincing that the audience has this suspension of disbelief. That you become the person you're acting. And then there's a person I also have to mention, Lee Strasberg, who was at the New York Actors Studio. He taught people like James Dean, Marilyn Monroe, Dustin Hoffman, Al Pacino, Paul Newman, just a few, just to name a few. But you can see that that this act method acting has really gone on to become something. All right, go ahead and we can advance. Right, so basically method acting is just a way that you get into the ability to have a sincere and emotionally expressive performance. As I said, it's really different than the classical acting, which is primarily action-based. So when I talk about method marketing, I'm gonna talk about emotions more than about the action-based, you know, get your marketing campaign and you know, here's your market research and here's your competitive research and we're going to go do this and do this and do this. This is really more the first thing is connecting emotionally with your customer. So go ahead. So after Dan mentioned method marketing, he says, I think we have a unique term. I actually found a book. This is really, he talks about, this is by Denny Hatch. And he talks in here about a marketing professional who wants to experience the emotion and to connect with their target market by inhabiting the life of their customers. So again, it's emotion-based versus action-based or reaction-based, reacting to any marketing research. So that's darn, the term was taken and the book name was already taken. So you can go ahead and advance, that's great. All right, so let's talk about marketing. So, you know, we all, I was taught, you know, you go out and you do a lot of market research, you do competitive research, and then you use that information to create your action items, your to-do list. So it's really, method marketing is going beyond just writing down a persona. It's about becoming the persona, okay? And that may be difficult in some cases, and that's the pros and cons, and we'll get to that soon. It's beyond the voice of the customer. It's really knowing at the essence level what is inside the head, what is under their skin. What is it that makes them stay up at night? What is it that inspires them, that makes them want to more and to have hope? You really become the customer. You walk in their shoes. You actually feel their emotions and you know their struggles, right? Things, the hot buttons. And then you, as a marketer, try to promise or deliver, that's the best part, deliver the salvation for any of their inner motives, right? So know what that salvation is, know what it looks like and talk in the terms that they understand. So I put a picture of a wishing well here because it's really, you want to create something that you wish already existed from their mindset. So it's really less about competitive research and trying to compete with other people, but you want to do something that's very novel and you want to focus on a tightly defined niche. So it's impossible to get inside the head and under the skin of the American population. Right, it's just too broad of a target market. It's too broad of a customer. But the benefit is that the more you understand your customer and let them define what it is that they need and they want and they wish for, then you get to become that customer. So, can go ahead and advance. Oh, yeah. All right, so I love this quote that people don't buy products. They buy better versions of themselves. Just let that sit in for a minute, right? I mean, how many commercials have you watched where they're talking about 5G network and the technical specs for their product, or how it's the lowest cost, get a discount. A better version of myself is not price-based. It's not technology-based. It's not benefits-based of, you know, what colors I can get my phone in or whatever. It is about me becoming a better person because of what your product delivers. So you've got to go beyond your product specs, right? So lots of companies do market from their perspective, cost base. So it really, you need to change your whole mindset. And what happens is that typically companies end up changing their product because they understand that it's really not about them, right? It's all about the customer. Again, it's experience-based, not product-focused. We use emotional-based buying versus this is the all the reasons, the logical reasons. And I'm going to mention Simon Sinek, who I absolutely adore and love, and he says, start with why. And that's a place that I would recommend. I think it's a common mistake that companies don't start with why. You know, what is the better version that people are seeking? Why do they want that? And then everything else will fall into place, I promise. All right, go ahead, Lily. So I have an old example, right? So you know I'm old because I'm going to use the Pepsi generation. I used it because it was really the first time. And I'm showing you at the bottom left there. They were quality. We're certified quality and you get more of it. You get 6 big bottles. It was all about price, right? That was really what they were you know, that's what they were promoting. That was their whole advertising, their whole marketing was. Twice as much for a nickel. God, remember when they were a nickel? No, I don't even remember. That's even before my time, right? But what is that saying? It's you know, twice as much for a nickel. And that's not going to make me a better person. It's not going to make a better version of me. And so then they went with, you're in the Pepsi generation. You've got a lot to live. Pepsi's got a lot to give. This was the first time that a company had really gone out on the limb and did something that was so radically different, right? This is, you know, one example. We have, you know, I think some other great examples, and I'll get into them in a minute. But I, you know, you have to talk about the history. So go ahead, you can advance. Right, so here we go. Nothing to do with sugary drinks, nothing to do with price, nothing to do with even quality. It was about a lifestyle. And then poor Coke, they thought it was about the flavor, and they went out with the new Coke, which has failed dramatically. Remember the taste test? And oh my word, I mean, talk about the wrong approach, right? So Whole Foods, right? Who I lovingly call Whole Paycheck. You know, whole people, whole planet, right? Versus Aldi's, which is all about competitive pricing. You know, and if you look at their, you know, P&L, definitely Whole Foods is succeeding. Dove's campaign for those women who've been targeted by it is about overcoming our self-confidence about our body, and, you know, versus other companies like Victoria's Secret, which is promoting the impossible dream. I mean, it's not a surprise to me that they're bankrupt, because it is an impossible dream, and it's not something I can relate to. It's not something I think that I can be. So anyway, and then you have Tesla. Okay, my favorite. I am a huge fan of Elon Musk. I think he's amazing. And I also own a Tesla. And here's a great example of value. It's not value price. This is versus cost price, right? For me, because I am cheap, I could only afford the $35,000 version of Tesla. So I couldn't justify spending $8,000 for a software download. However, for 60 days, Elon teased me with the ability to be in the grocery store, and it's pouring down rain, and I could just summon my car. I just said, please come get me. And my car would drive through the parking lot and come and pick me up at the front door of Publix, okay? Now, he took it away from me, and now he wants $8,000 to re-download it into my car. Now, you and I both know that to add some digits to my computer battery, or my computer on my car, is not gonna cost him $8,000, but definitely there is a huge value, a better version of myself that has a car that literally comes and gets me. I mean, almost as good, not quite as good as my wife, but for $8,000, right? That's a better version of myself, right? And then the last one I want to talk about is Apple iPod. If you think about the commercials that you saw for Apple iPod, go ahead, Lily, you can advance. It wasn't about, you know, the quality, and it wasn't about, what the product specs were. It was about a lifestyle. Look at these people, right? Who do you want to be? The people on the wall or the guy in front, right? Right. So this is about enjoying your music, enjoying life, and dancing and moving, and this is about getting inside the heads of the consumers who are using and consuming these earbuds, right? So, all right, go ahead. So again, products are created in the factory, but brands and marketing are created in the mind, and then I added in hearts of our customers. So Walter Landau, it's a very famous quote of his, but when I think about Tesla, my connection is very much one of a love. All right. Go ahead, Lily. Let's roll this video if you can. The idea is that our words are very powerful, and our goal is to make that emotional connection. So we're going to get to see an example of that. Right. This wasn't what I was expecting, Lilia. I was expecting, that's interesting. Okay. I was expecting the video of the beggar on the corner. So. Stop for just a second. So I apologize. I'm not exactly sure what happened. Can I show the video that I was hoping we would see?
Sure.
Okay. I'm sorry about that. I don't know what happened. I tested it and everything. All right. This is the one I thought we were going to see.
So while you're calling that up, guys, I got a great question from Bob Nelson. But I want to, that's the only one we've received so far. So could you send in some questions? We're going to take a break after this video to do a quick Q&A, and then she's going to finish, then she's going to continue with her presentation. So please send the questions in through the Q&A option on the bottom of your screen.
All right, it's a minute 47 seconds. So if you have to go to the bathroom, you can make it. This is really worth seeing.
We're not hearing sound for what it's worth.
Oh, yes. Hold on. Oh, I need that Zoom class here. Okay. Here we go. Got it.
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Absolutely.
The man wrote the sign from his perspective. I'm blind, please help. the woman.
Cheryl, whatever you did to adjust your audio, it now is coming in very choppy. And if you could go back to whatever audio setup you had before.
Okay, how about now?
Much better.
Is it still bad?
And we do have some questions. Okay. So that was a beautiful video. You were making a reflection on it. Go ahead.
Yeah, so my reflection is this, that the woman wrote the sign from her perspective. So she said, it's a beautiful day. Yes, we can all relate to that. The people walking by this man could say, yes, it is a beautiful day. And so what she did then is then pull, once she got your attention and said something you could relate to, then she came in and said, and I can't see it. And so you saw the difference. You saw the way that the money poured in to this person who was able to first speak to his customers. And that's what I hope for you as a result of this, of our talk today.
Perfect.
All right. So we can take some questions. If you want to go to the prior slide, Lilia, because we're not going to talk about this until after the questions.
So Sarah Vasquez.
Yeah, thank you.
Sarah Vasquez asked, I think, a great question, and I'm really excited to hear your answer. She said, this all seems to be based around commercials and videos and big budgets. We don't have a budget, correct equipment to create advertising videos. How do you apply these techniques to platforms like Facebook and Instagram? And I would just say broadly, how do you apply these techniques to small businesses with limited staff and money?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah, so what I showed you obviously has some great cinematic value, but it was a cardboard sign. What I showed you, the example I showed you, was a cardboard sign. It's every word you use on your website. It's every word you use in an email. It's every word you use in a brochure. It's what you put in the window of your shop. It's not about the cinematic value. Our beggar had a cardboard sign with a Sharpie. And so it's not about where or how much. It's really more about every single communication you have should really be based, come from the place of your customer, and should have the words that they relate to, should have the things that they're, it's every communication, even when they walk in your shop, right? Or anytime you have a conversation. Here's a great example. So I used to live at an ashram. And so I would work on the phone. I would answer the phones for a certain shift. And I would always answer the phone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. This is Satchidananda Ashram. How can I serve you? Because our role at the ashram was about service. And so even the way you answer the phone can communicate that you understand what the customer's looking for, why they call, what's in it for them. So hopefully I answered that. I mean, hopefully that
makes sense. Here's a great example. Christian Pagliaccio wrote, I'm in the flower industry and I was wondering how can I make my approach more emotional for my customers to make them be a better version of themselves using digital marketing?
So the way, it's not as much about writing it. It's about what you're offering. So you may need to go right back to the, source, right back to the essence. Of what it is you're offering. And does it really meet the need of your customer, of who it is and what they need and what keeps them up at night? So I would really recommend you go back to basics, go back to your customer. Let me give you another example. I worked for Mary Kay and we had 600 at the time, I think they have close to a million now, 650,000 independent representatives. And my goal was to create digital solutions to their shoebox where they kept all of their customers with the colors they used. And the stacks of greeting cards for every birthday card they sent out. I went in the field and traveled for 1 week with one of our top producing sales reps. And, this woman is a millionaire. She drives a pink Humvee, okay? And so I said, what is it that makes you successful? What is it, the connection you're trying to make? And so as a result, I came back to Mary Kay. I worked in the e-commerce division and we came up with the CRM, the pink CRM. We came up with Pink Mountain Arts. where the independent agents could send out these e-greetings that were all Mary Kay and about beauty and self-confidence. So, you know, it's really not about how do you write it. It's what are you offering and does it resonate? So I'll go back.
You know, I want to tell a story that I think it moved me when I heard it. And it's directly related to the flower industry, but it's a little bit different than selling live flowers. So one of the folks who's in our course is named Yolanda Boylis. And I think I saw Yolanda is actually here today. And so hi, Yolanda.
Cheers.
Yeah, so I wanted to tell you her story, which moved me so much. So Yolanda was suffering from cancer, and she tells this story publicly and tells it to her customers and her staff. And she was in the hospital and people sent her roses. And she was dying. And these roses became a metaphor for her body. And she watched them day after day start to droop and their leaves were falling, and she felt with them her own life ebbing away. And it's interesting because I think that was there's a Disney movie, maybe it's Sleeping Beauty, where they use the rose metaphor. Anyway. Beauty and the Beast, thank you. Mm-hmm. I'm not quite as up on my Disney as I should be. But I remember that image of the rose and the petals falling and that signifying death. So she watched this process and it upset her. And she started to do research into preserving roses. And she was watching videos and she began to, from her literal deathbed, preserve these roses that were coming to her. And she developed her own methodology for preserving roses, one that was so effective that all the roses that she began to receive actually were being preserved. And in so doing, in the act of preserving the roses, she healed herself and kind of miraculously was able to get up out of that hospital, take those roses with her, and is, you know, alive and well today. And that's the story she tells about why she started her preserved rose business.
That's a great story, Dan. And I know I hate to sound commercial here, but it's about that's her personal legend, right? She decided to go beyond the traditional florist. And took her situation and her life, how the things life dealt her, and created a personal legend that there's no amount of market research or there's no amount of copywriting that could have led her to that path. That's a beautiful story. Thank you for sharing that. That's beautiful.
And I want to quickly ask one more question from Bob Nelson from the VMT. And then Ross Kahn has a great question that's going to set up the second half of your presentation. Okay. Bob Nelson, founder of VMT, said, how does method marketing differ from empathy-based marketing?
Well, you know, there might be like a gradation, right? That, you know, nothing's ever black or white. But I think empathy marketing is starting to get you closer to method marketing. But method marketing is not just having empathy and then going away at the end of the day. I mean, you think about people that did method acting, you know, Tom Hanks, who didn't shave or shower and lost, I think, 60 pounds during the filming of The Castaway. You're making a commitment to really living, breathing, walking. So I think empathy marketing is definitely better than just fact-based and action-based marketing. But I think maybe it's going a little bit further. We can talk more about that.
Perfect. And then Ross Kahn, and this is perfect setup, and Lily, you can go ahead and start the presentation again. Ross Kahn asked, I can see the value of getting inside the customer's head, but how do you achieve that?
Perfect.
Perfect question.
Go ahead, Lilia. And I did share a little bit. I don't know when the question came in, but, you know, literally going out and working as your customer is a great way to do that. So, so I said three techniques, but I'm going to give you four techniques here. Frequent field visits, right? That's definitely something that I recommend. that you go visit your customer in their environment, schedule day in the life experiences, not just for you and your team, but also I would encourage you to get your execs involved. Because when you come to them, if you're working in a bigger company, and you come to them with this cockamamie idea of Pink Mountain Arts, they're going to really understand because they've been there too. So another thing that this is a requirement that I had, double checking. People call it different things, but when you go into a call center, if you happen to have a call center, this was a mandatory thing for all of my team that they had to have mandatory sessions of listening to the customer on the phone, sharing a headset. Right? That was another way you can do it. And then, you know, listen intently. Don't just sit there and go, yeah, another person is, you know, pissed off because they can't get the, you know, the resort they wanted. But what is the why? Why is it that they're talking to you? Why is it that they purchased from you? What is their unhappiness? And you can uncover some opportunities. We've got a dancing mouse, Lily. secret shopping. Okay. A lot of companies will hire this out. They don't hire that. You be the secret shopper. I don't know, if you own a small shop or you own a flower shop and you have employees, go incognito, dress up, put in some sunglasses, put on a mustache. I don't know. But you need to feel the experience as if you were the customer. Call. You know, disguise your voice, whatever. But you really want to see the whole product in the process as the buyer. Subscribe to your own emails, your own direct mail, your own full phone solicitation. And I think if anybody knows the saying, ABC, always be closing. In this case, always be shopping. Always be the person that you're trying to attract. And then now, let's say there's no way that you are able to be able to get inside the shoes and the skin. Then I recommend that you think about, the undercover boss, I just saw that go by, that you hire subject matter experts. Let's say, for example, one of the jobs that, and we're gonna talk about this in a minute, one of the things that I learned about myself through this process is that I really do become my customer. And so, for example, when I worked at MDVIP, which is a concierge medicine company, their target customers were really people that had coronary heart disease, diabetes, a lot of various cancer, very serious illnesses. And what I found is it was emotionally very, very hard on me. And so in that case, or in a case like that, I would say hire a subject matter expert, engage them, and listen to them, all right? A lot of companies have customer panels or advisory boards, but you need somebody that you can like run every single piece of copy through, or every single script that you use to answer the phone, or every single postcard, or whatever it is, every single sign, right? So an advisory board that meets once a quarter is not going to cut it. So when I was at Blue Green Resorts, you know, we had several people who owned Blue Green timeshares. And so not only would I engage them, but then I would listen to them, even if I didn't agree. Okay. So there's some ideas. There's four techniques.
And Deborah Glabo asked, how would you adjust these four techniques for a service company?
The same thing. There's really no difference. You buy the service as if you are a customer. Services are sold on the phone. They're sold in, I don't see a whole lot of difference. Right?
Yeah. And Lilia, could you go back one slide? Cheryl Goldstein asked, do you recommend focus groups?
Well, I do, but those are typical research methodologies that are used it's market research. And a couple of problems I've seen with focus groups is number one, people don't tend to be honest. They kind of follow the leader. They follow the herd, and there's a lot of research about focus group mentality. And so, I find that the cost benefit is not as great as for me to spend my time actually going and being with somebody who is my customer, my target customer, and, really spend a day in the life. But It's a traditional market research technique, but that glass wall is a whole world of separation.
I tend to agree that focus groups, they do provide useful information, but it's definitely not sufficient.
Right. And
I wanted to let you know, guys, that there's another, I would add a couple other techniques to this, and I'm actually doing a whole presentation about it. It's called Free Tools to Find Your Customers Online. It's on December 2nd. So if you're interested, sign up for it. It's another free BizHack Live. But we'll kind of tackle some other tools like Google Trends, Google Keyword Planner, Facebook Insights that I would add to this list that I think can help get you in the same direction. Yeah. Jennifer Watson asked, focus groups are subjective for sure, but they should be done with experts. That can get expensive.
Yes. About $10,000 per focus group is what I would budget. Or in my experience, that's what it's cost. Hey, Jennifer, it's nice you could make it. All right, let's keep going, Lilia. Let's try to get through the rest. So some tips and tricks. Again, the customer advisory boards are one step closer. If you don't have one, I highly recommend you start that. Again, pause, reflect, evaluate every single marketing message as if you were a customer. And that really is hard. It's like you're so close to the forest or the trees, you can't see the forest, right? And again, it's really, if you don't have a large staff and you don't have the money to to hire a bunch of your customers, this is a huge discipline. But my recommendation is anytime you're creating a message, run it by somebody who is the person you're trying to interest, right? And then again, if you have people who come to you and they're talking about features and functions and 5G and stuff that really doesn't matter, be sure every single thing you talk about, just ask why. Go back to Simon. What is the why and who cares, right? Because at the end of the day, I don't buy 5G. I buy a way to connect with my family and friends. I buy a way to emotionally reach out, and it's not about 5G. Although it's nice when it doesn't drop or when I have good quality. I encourage you to dig deep, get the emotional trigger. See, and if you don't feel it, you don't have it. And I think you're going to know it, right? So, all right, let's keep going, Lilia. I'm going to try to get through this before we have to go. So pros and cons. The pro is that, it can be very cost effective. It's a lot more cost effective than running focus groups in your major markets and, spending $10,000 per recruiting and gifting and so on. It also makes sure that whatever you're offering or whatever you're saying, it's relevant, it's engaging, it's believable, and it has an impact. So the cons are this. There are some places you really don't want to go. There's some heads you'd rather not go into. I think the MDVIP example for me, my happiness was impacted by constantly thinking about health challenges and people that had to struggle with them on a daily basis, and that the fears and things that motivated them was really not a happy place for me. I mean, I spent almost 10 years at Blue Green Resorts, and I'll tell you why, because I like thinking about going on vacation. I love thinking about beautiful resorts. And, so that's a little bit of a con if your product is not a good place to be. So, all right, go ahead, Lilia, next slide. And the other thing I want to talk about here is being improvisation. When you are really inside the head of your customer and you know what they're doing, right? And you're probably doing it yourself, right? Having your marketing team being completely empowered to get inside the head, and when the Super Bowl goes dark, they have the absolute power to put out a brilliant tweet such as this, right? You can still dunk in the dark. The Super Bowl lights and electricity went out, and they got millions and millions of impressions of people that saw this tweet, responded, retweeted, reacted, engaged with the product, right? Because Oreos is the kind of company that watches the Super Bowl like I do, right? So when the opportunities like this arise, make sure you're prepared to strike. And that requires sometimes trust and empowerment, unless you're the person who is in charge of the Twitter account. All right, go ahead. So I'm going to leave you. There's a couple of really good resources. I talked about it here. Denny Hatch's book is still available. There's not very many copies available, but he does still have, it's still out there. And as I said before, I think the Simon Sinek, he's all over the place. There's all kinds of resources. You can TED Talks and books and webinars with Simon Sinek. So powerful. Start with why. And that is really the essence of getting method marketing. And then, of course, if you want to go all the way back to the origins, the An Actor Prepares, that book. So, next. All right, this is the last poll, and I appreciate you all. I appreciate all the familiar faces in the crowd. I appreciate you coming and supporting me. And I just like to know, did you get anything out of this? It's always nice to know. If you got at least one gold nugget, one thing you're going to walk away and be able to implement, that's what makes it all worthwhile. So either yes, I got more than one. No, I don't know. Maybe later when I have another cup of coffee.
Well, while they're doing that, we have answered all the open questions. We have time for a couple more. If anybody has them, put it in the chat or the Q&A. But in the meantime, I did want to ask you about, there's a really interesting point you're making. You know, one of the challenges of method acting is it could be very hard on the actor. And what you're saying is the method marketing approach, if you're working with a company that has an audience of folks that are not well in some way, or a product that you don't find meaningful and believe in, it can actually be very hard on you personally. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, it's funny because when you first brought up when you first witnessed me doing method marketing, it was a point of reflection for me because there's been several jobs in my past that, I love the company, I love what they're doing, but I didn't love the job. I was not the right person for the job, right? 10 years at Blue Green, but not even a year at MDVIP. And that really resonated with me that I struggled when I was there. And so I don't know how, all I can tell you is from my standpoint, what I went through. And I just know that about myself and that I'm self-realized and know that I've got to make sure that I'm doing something that's good for my heart and my soul. And that's why I'm doing personal legend coaching now. Because it is something I do believe in. I can do it with my whole heart and soul, and I don't have to worry about being diabetic or having coronary heart disease as my persona that I have to live and breathe.
Right. Yeah, so let me describe to you guys what method marketing looked like and why I coined the term. So I was actually, Sheryl was helping BizHack on a campaign that we were doing targeting public relations professionals. And we were looking at a video that we were going to use in a Facebook ad. And I remember at some point, she kind of closed her eyes. And she took a beat and she said, I'm thinking right now about the public relations agency owner, somebody who's been doing this for 20 years, has an agency that's been very successful and it's suddenly been disrupted by COVID. And I'm imagining how they feel. I'm feeling a little scared and a little bit unprepared and I'm feeling like the world is kind of pushed ahead without me. And I was just like, what the hell is she doing? And then she's like, okay, and now I'm watching this video. And then she's like, can you play it again? And she played it again. And then she's like, you know what? This isn't hitting me in the heart. It's hitting me in the head. And let's change this. And why don't we add this image? And what about this? And it was like, holy God, that was unbelievable. And I realized, guys, this is not about resources, right? This is not about resources. This is about empathy. It's about your head and your heart. It's about putting yourself in the shoes of the customer. It's about listening. And I got to guarantee you that if you do this with an open heart and head, it will transform your marketing. It will transform your business. And so it starts with really understanding why, your motivation for starting the company. And that's why Simon Sinek is so important. And that's why in the BizHack methodology, the foundation of all digital marketing is your business story. And your business story is an articulation of your why. Why did you start this business? Why did you run it? Right? And once you've established your business story, you then inhabit the shoes of your customer and you ask, how does my personal motivation connect with their needs and wants? That's called the story of me and then the story of us. How are we aligned in our motivation, our needs, and our wants? And that is the magic. Once you've done that, you then apply the five pillars, the objective, the audience, the offer, the video, and the messaging, and you're off to the races. But if you don't have that solid foundation of what is your personal motivation and how does it connect with your audience's wants and needs, there's no way to be successful as a marketer. And I've never seen anybody vivify that approach the way I watched Sheryl that day. So it's really something, Sheryl, to see you kind of articulate something that you've been doing instinctively for years in such a beautiful and like to use what something you've been doing from your heart and to talk about it and articulate it with your head. And I love the research you did. And I will confess that while we were on this call, I emailed Denny Hatch. I was able to Google him and find his email address. And I wrote him, and I'll let you know, inviting him to be a BizHack Live speaker. And I'll let you guys know soon if he says yes.
Oh, that would be wonderful. Well, thank you for your very, very kind words, Dan. And I am honored that you actually suggested this. It's just, when it's something you do on a daily basis, you don't even think about it. I didn't even think it was, you know, anything to talk about, but evidently it was. And I'm glad that you all were here. And if anybody is looking to become their own personal legend, I think you asked a question that, what if I'm working for a company I don't believe in, or I don't believe in the product? And you know what? I highly recommend get in touch with me, because life is too short to be unhappy. Life is too short to be doing things you don't love. And there's definitely a lot more to life than being unhappy and just grinding through just to get to the end. So yeah, here you go, personallegendcoaching.com. I was totally blown away it was available. And reach out to me. I'd love to hear from you.
So one of the benefits, guys, to coming to these sessions or even being a part of our season pass is that you get a copy of these slides. You'll get Sheryl's website and her contact information. Oftentimes, our guests include tip sheets or tutorials that are in bonus. All of this comes with attending today, and also you can get those automatically, even if you don't register, if you join our season pass. And that also helps us make sure that we can keep doing this into 2021 and beyond. And I'm going to share my screen really quickly just to talk about a couple other things. So as I mentioned, we're going to have our scholarship info session. That's at noon on Friday, where I answer your questions about the scholarship. Next week, we have Zoom Mastery for Business with Rosemary Ravenal. The week after that, Mobile Marketing in Latin America. The week after that, our graduation party for our current group of amazing participants in the course, several of whom are here today. Thank you. And then week after that, the five pillars of digital marketing. And then some other great topics, including on December 2nd, with Emerge America's free tools to find your ideal customer. I hope you do support us by joining us for a season pass. And with that, I want to say thank you, Sheryl, and thanks to all of you guys.
Thank you, Dan.
For being here today. Really appreciate it. Great to see you, Ami and Bob. Great question. Carolyn, Sheryl Goldstein, awesome question. Danielle, David Phillip, looking forward to our chat. Jane Snell, Jennifer Hudson, our amazing partner in crime, John Thornton from the current cohort, Callie, Lucy Lewis, Maria Luisa, Othar, Ross, Sal, Sarah, Serena, Susan, TT, Ted, and of course Yolanda, who has allowed me to so generously share her preserved roses story. So thank you all. Thank you, Ross, for your great questions. Look forward to seeing you at future BizHack Live sessions.